One of the points of today's Ofsted report, that first report that's been leaked, was that staff were slow to engage with local and national initiatives such as the Prevent programme. Now, the Prevent programme, according to the government, is supposed to do several things. It's supposed to respond to the ideological challenge we face from terrorism, provide practical help to prevent people from being drawn into terrorism, and work with a wide range of sectors, including education, where there are risks of radicalisation that we need to deal with, as the government puts it. Well, Douglas Murray is a writer and associate director of the right-leaning think tank, the Henry Jackson Society. Jahan Mahmood has advised the government in countering extremism and mentored young people deemed to be at risk of radicalisation. Douglas Murray first, how far should schools be responsible for countering extremism?
If I can just start by saying we're actually a cross-partisan think tank. We have Labour and Conservative members, so it's not correct.
I beg your pardon. It wasn't meant as a slight. We tried to be accurate and we got it wrong.
To get the question, how much should schools be involved? Well, simply the Prevent programme, the Prevent agenda, is part of this government's agenda. It's very important to make sure that the mood music that can be created, which allows people to perceive radicalism as an acceptable way of life or an acceptable viewpoint, must be countered. And obviously, schools have a role in that, as universities do, as a huge number of sectors do. Schools at the moment are just simply at the forefront of this for clear reasons, which your report showed.
And how far should schools go? How far should the authorities go in trying to tackle extremism?
Well, the Trojan horse case is about people being encouraged to lead what I would regard as being parallel lives. You heard it, I think, in the rhetoric of the parent who you interviewed in your report, who talked about what the Muslim governors might like to do if they had more complete control. And I think this is very concerning to large numbers of the public who would like to think that in Britain in this year, and this period, that it wouldn't matter which school you went to, you would have a broad understanding of the country, of the culture, and although there would be differences to your religious ethos in the school, it would not encourage a form of separatism, which is, I think, one of the things which this whole affair has exposed.
Would you like to see Prevent being tougher?
Well, I'd like to see Prevent do all sorts of things more effectively, certainly. I think there is certainly a risk that it has become something which, you know, the Prime Minister famously spoke about, but which has been allowed to drift. I think there's you could certainly see that there are parts of the civil service that regard it as the Prime Minister's opinion rather than policy, yes.
All right. Jahan Mahmood, how far should schools be responsible for countering extremism?
I think we've got to be careful that we don't disproportionately focus on one community and end up isolating them. There's a great chance that can happen. Of course, any narrative within a school should be inclusive.
And which community are you talking about?
The Muslim community, of course, in Birmingham, because I've actually done some work at Golden Hillock as well, where I was called in a number of years back.
Well, tell us about that.
Yeah, I was called in because the school was actually underperforming, and one of the issues that was highlighted by a consultant there was that there are certain cultural hindrances. Now, when I did a comparison against another school which drew in from exactly the same demographics, we realised that the other school, Waverloo, was doing remarkably well, whereas Golden Hillock was underperforming, and that was partly down to leadership. The PVET was then invited in and took over the governorship, but the authorities seem to have thrown the book at them. They don't have an extremism issue as such. This is more about isolationism and not having a kind of inclusive narrative.
And do you think the policy is causing the isolationism?
I think absolutely, yeah. I think we disproportionately, when we deploy Prevent, it is disproportionately focused on Muslims. But one of the great problems with Prevent, and I've advised the government on this quite closely for a number of years, both the previous Labour government and the current coalition government, is that we seem to disproportionately focus on ideology as opposed to some of the grievances and the other issues. I mean, I received a phone call 2 days ago, which was really in connection to how the local counter-terrorism unit had gone into two schools specifically and talked to teachers about ideology. I mean, look, this isn't an ideological issue. Young people are not actually vulnerable to the Al-Qaeda ideology. We shouldn't be going into schools like that. What we should be talking about is an inclusive narrative.
Sledgehammer to crack a nut, is it?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, teachers were ringing me saying, look, Jahan, you've advised the government on Prevent. And actually, it was completely inapplicable. All it's done is actually isolated us further. And how can the local counter-terrorism unit expect us to be experts overnight on a subject they themselves don't understand, which is a very, very good point.
Douglas Murray?
As for the applicability of prevent, it is obvious why prevent might be used and prevent officers and others be used to look at Muslim schools. And I don't think there's anything disproportionate about that. Both this government and the previous government, the government of Gordon Brown, the Labour government of Tony Blair, identified this as the prime security risk to our society, a kind of Islamist extremism. So it's not surprising that if there is an ideological question, it might mean that people are going to focus more on, for instance, Muslim schools
Quaker schools. What if the effect is to make some Muslim children feel more isolated?
Well, I mean, that's to say that trying to deal with a problem causes the problem, which I think just gets you stuck in a circle, does it not? It means you leave it alone. You hear reports of segregation of the sexes, segregation of non-Muslim for Muslim children, and you just accept it.
Jahan Mahmood?
No, I disagree. I don't think... I know that Douglas has no actual expertise on prevent and how it's been kind of deployed on a grassroots level. He's never gone into some of these schools.
Really?
He doesn't actually understand some of the issues at the grassroots level because the government has disproportionately looked at ideology. And for young people, what you don't want to do is start talking about ideology because you're introducing it to them. What we have to be very careful about is what we introduce them to and how we introduce it as well. So I don't think he's got any forte expertise in that subject at all. And the other point that
What about the point he was making, that it can't be ignored? You can't ignore it.
No, but the thing is, you don't isolate a community by focusing entirely on them and then bring in a prevent strategy that seems to focus more on them. What you do is you talk about an inclusive narrative and an environment where they grow up respecting people of other cultures, of other religions, of other ethnicities. That's what needs to happen at a young age.
Yeah. First of all, I'm not going to go over my own CV with you, and if you think you know about my own, you don't. But let me just
have
get back to the
schools,
point. I've been to Muslim schools in this country. I've been to non-Muslim schools in this country. I'm not going to get into Golden Hillock or another. The point is this. It seems to many people very surprising that when what seem to be very hard-line views and some possibly very extremist views seem to be making their way into a sector of the education system, instead of trying to deal with them, we keep on getting this pushback and this negation, this denial that there's anything to look at. It is clear to a lot of people that there is something to look at. I think, by the way, the coming days are going to, both in the media and elsewhere, expose far more subjects of concern in this area than we've seen even to date. I would suggest in that situation, it would be incumbent upon people who are self-appointed and otherwise for Muslim communities in this country not to keep on saying you shouldn't look at this or using the wrong tools to look at this, but to sort this out.
Last word to you, Jahan Mahmood.
No, on that point, to be honest with you, I absolutely agree. I think this is an issue that we as Muslims really need to focus on more. And one of the great worries that I've had about this issue is that sometimes the lack of Islamic awareness among young people and also the lack of input from scholars, and I mean scholars of a higher level, jurists, for instance, who have not been able to properly explain the framework of interpretation to Muslim communities, who failed in their own job and responsibility to Muslim communities. So on that point, I'm not an apologist, and I absolutely agree the Muslim community can do more, and actually it would work a lot better was it coming from Muslims as opposed to from the government and certain think tanks have an agenda of their own.
You have to sort that out yourselves then.
Yeah, doing for so long?
There's very little evidence of it working then, is there?
Well, the thing is, you've got to start somewhere, and the news doesn't always focus on some of the good projects. It seems to focus on the negativity of it all.
We look forward to hearing the good news one day.
All right, we will end it there. Douglas Murray, you got the last word. That's on your CV. Jahan Mahmood, too, grateful to you. 5:30, more or less, is on the air tomorrow afternoon at 4:30, and Tim Harford can tell us all about it.